So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 247. So guys, as most of you would be knowing that in this series, we try to discuss some concepts that can be of use to you if you are preparing for any competitive exam, right? So here we try to discuss current affairs related to economics and finance and the concepts which are underlying them, right? So here we are going to discuss 5 questions. And before moving to question number 1, I would like to ask you to subscribe to our channel. So those of you who have done, that's very good. And those of you who are new here, who do not know about our channel or who are not connected to us, do subscribe to our channel. Press this button. It can help you to stay in touch with us. And don't forget to press this bell icon, which is going to update you about every notification that comes up, right? And after that, don't forget to join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible, right? So moving ahead to question number 1 for today. I hope the screen is perfectly visible to you. And let me read the first question out. It says, dash is the term used in the hydrocarbon industry and refers to an agreement between contractor and government whereby contractor bears all exploration risks, production and development cost in return for the stipulated share of profit or production resulting from this effort. So guys, see here, this question, it is talking about the hydrocarbon industry. That means we can understand that it talks about oil, natural gas or petrol, right? Basically the mining for hydrocarbon industry. As you can see here, it talks about exploration risks, production and development costs. So here is exploration involved, that means mining exploration, there is involvement of mining or drilling, right? So you have to tell what is this contract called out of these 5 options. This has been in news due to a recent case. Okay, moving ahead to the solution for this question. And the solution is option D, which means production sharing agreement, production sharing contract. So your answer is production sharing contract. So let us now understand what is meant by this production sharing contract. Okay, so it became widely adopted as a part of new exploration and licensing policy launched by government in 1997. So for enhanced exploration of oil and gas resources in the country. So the main aim behind this was to explore new oil and gas resources to meet the expanding energy demands of the country, right? After that, how this model works, you can see here that this is based on a principle of profit sharing between 2 entities, government and the contractor. So contractor is going to bear all the costs and after that government is going to reimburse those costs to contractor, right? So whatever, see, if there is a contractor who has taken a contract and he is going to mine or he is going to explore for oil or natural gas resources, after that if they find some resource which is commercially viable or they can make some benefit out of it, then what they do is whatever revenue they make, first of all they are going to compensate the contractor for the cost which that entity has borne, and after that whatever is left, the leftover part is shared between both the entities. That is why we say the principle of profit sharing. So when a person, here you can see, expected to share it with the government the profit from his venture as per the percentage given in his bid. So whatever the agreement says, according to that percentage, that ratio, the profits are shared, right? So here, why are we talking about this? Recently, Supreme Court, it upheld a foreign arbitration award favoring Vedanta and Videocon Industries Limited, allowing these 2 companies to recover $499 million, which were spent on developing Rawa oil and gas fields off the coast of Andhra Pradesh, right? So see, what was this case? as you can see here, it dates back to 1990s when a production sharing contract, it was provided to this company called Cairn India Limited. It was later acquired by Vedanta. That is why here we are talking about Vedanta, right? So this company got this contract from government to explore this oil and gas fields in Andhra, off the coast of Andhra Pradesh, right? So obviously, if they did this work, they must have spent some money. Now they were asking government that, okay, we have spent this much money, we have spent $499 million, give them back to us, and after that whatever is left is the profit. But government told them that, see, we cannot pay you the whole amount because in our contract there was a certain cap on this expenditure. That is why we are not going to reimburse you the whole amount. But so this case has been in courts since then. As you can see here, it was in Malaysia also. So why this foreign country involved? See, because this is a case involving government of India or public government of India. That is why. So in such cases which involves government of India, there can be intervention of a foreign entity for unbiasedness, right? So just as if two friends are fighting, what the third friend does is they try to approach a party who is neutral or who is not biased towards either of the party, right? So that is why the involvement of a foreign country. So in all the cases, this Malaysian court also, they upheld a foreign arbitration award favoring Vedanta. So they gave the verdict in favor of Vedanta Limited that, okay, government should compensate them with all of their losses, right? And now, after that, when this verdict came up, government filed against this verdict also. But after that, now Supreme Court has recently again favored the companies that yes, they should be compensated for the cost that they have borne. And this cap which was put, you can see here, according to the petition, PSC stipulated that the respondent should carry out the specified work, including drilling of 21 wells at a maximum cost of 188.98 million plus 5% dollar, called the base development cost. So this was what was in the contract. That is why government was saying we are not going to compensate you more than this, but the company was demanding the full compensation, right? So now Supreme Court has also favored the companies, right? So this was the case, and I hope now you understand the meaning of a production sharing contract. Moving ahead to the next question for today. Here is our next question. Okay, the second question, it talks about some K percent rule. Out of the following statements mentioned below, you have to select the correct statement about the K percent rule. Let's see what the correct answer for this question is. And the correct answer is option A. Okay, that means K percent rule, it states that central bank should increase the money supply by a constant percentage every year. So guys, before learning about this K percent rule, let us go to a concept which is called, as you can see here, the concept is called monetarism. So I think you can guess from the name that it somehow relates to the word money. It comes from the word money. So monetarism is a school of thought in economics which says that money supply is very important. Just as Keynesian economics focuses on demand, here monetarists, they focus on money supply, that central banks, they can control the situations in an economy, or they can mitigate any risks that are there in the economy by controlling the money supply. So basically they are saying it is the most significant. You can see here a branch of economics that singles out monetary growth and related policy as the most important driver of future inflation, right? So monetarism focusing on money supply, and this monetarism, it has the theory of quantity theory of money, this theory is central to this concept of monetarism. Now, what is this quantity theory of money? You must have heard about Milton Friedman, the founder of monetarism, very famous economist. After that, talking about quantity theory of money. See, quantity theory of money, this is a theory which gives you a formula. Here a formula is given to you. So this theory, it says that the extent by which money is exchanged in an economy, it leads to creation of more and more money. That means the more number of hands from which money passes through, or the velocity of money, as you can see, the velocity of circulation. So the higher the circulation of money, the higher is going to be the price level in an economy, or higher inflation in an economy. So this quantity theory of money, it places emphasis on the circulation of money. So if we consider the case of demonetization, what happened there? Suddenly the money circulation stopped. That is why India's growth has been lagging, right? That is one of the factors behind India's lagging growth. So the more the circulation, the more is going to be inflation, leading to more growth in the economy. This is what quantity theory of money says. This is known as Fisher equation. All those of you having commerce or economics background must be knowing about it, named after Irving Fisher. So this quantity theory of money, this is central to the concept of monetarism, and this monetarism leads us to the K% rule. So under K% rule, what is said is that central bank or the regulatory authority, they should release or increase some more supply of money every year, not too much, but a certain particular amount. In economy, they should increase money supply by that particular percentage every year so that economy can grow. So guys, many a times we have discussed the example of Japan, that how they are trying to boost the inflation so that they can get the economy back on track of growth, but they are unable to do so, right? So do you see they're trying to boost inflation to boost growth? Similarly, this K% rule says that if central bank is going to increase the money supply every year in a limited amount, that is going to lead to a sustained growth. Right? And this money supply, this percentage, so this K is the percent by which this money supply should be increased, and that should be in accordance with the growth of real GDP each year. So if there is a developing country which has higher growth in that country, in a developing country, this K% should be higher. Whereas if there is a developed economy which has a lesser potential for growth, lesser growth of GDP, the K% can be lower, right? So this K% should match the growth of real GDP. I hope you understand this concept. So here we talked about three concepts: QTM, monetarism, and K% rule, right? Moving ahead. So here is your third question for today, which says SEBI has recently tweaked the rules for mutual fund purchases regarding calculation of NAV, right? Starting 1st January, mutual fund purchases will be calculated based on the net asset value of the day. Which of the following days will be used for the calculation purpose? You have to tell that. So guys, SEBI has recently changed some rules. We are not talking about the multi-cap funds, the rules which have been changed for multi-cap funds. Here we are talking about the rules that they have changed for calculation of NAV. And they have changed a basis for calculation. Calculation of NAV would be done on a particular day. You have to tell which of the following day it is. Moving ahead. Okay. So let us first understand that what is this question saying. The correct option is E, which means it would be calculated on the day the investor's money reaches the asset manager. So guys, see, whenever, let's say, there is an investor. If I want to invest in a mutual fund scheme, what I look at? NAV or the net asset value is one of the driving factors which pulls investors towards mutual fund scheme. So net asset value, the return which mutual fund is giving, right? So I check out the NAV on a particular day on which I want to invest, and I see, okay, there is a mutual fund scheme having a very good sustainable NAV, and let me invest into that, right? So I'll go online, I'll fill all the formalities or documentation which is required, and after that we'll make a, I would have to make a payment of certain amount according to the scheme which I'm investing in, right? So they can, so the rules till now, they said that you can see here that under the current rules, NAV of the same day is considered for purchase of less than 2 lakh. See, if I'm investing into the mutual fund scheme today, I would want, I'm investing according to today's NAV, right? And I would be getting units of mutual funds according to that particular NAV, right? And I'm investing, I'm basing my investing decision on that particular day's NAV. That is why current day's NAV is important to the investor, because they would be getting units according to that particular value, right? Now this rule, it says that NAV of the same day would be considered only if the transactions, as you can see here, even if the, okay, let's first talk about this rule, that this rule, it said that if you submit your purchase application before 1 p.m., then the day that would be used for calculation is going to be the day of submission of application. But you will have to submit the application before 1 p.m. If you submit it after 1, then the NAV of next day would be used for calculation, which might not be good for the investor. But now rules have changed, and they are saying that now we are not going to consider the day of submission of application, but the day when your money reaches the AMC. As you can see here, that investors, the day when investors' money reaches the the day when investors' money reaches the asset manager, that particular day's NAV is going to be used for calculation. Now if you want that, if I'm investing into scheme today and I want calculation according to today's NAV only, then I will have to make sure that I submit the application and my money also reaches to the asset manager today only, right? So earlier the rule said that only you have to submit the application when we are going to consider the day of submission of application, not the day on which money reaches, right? Now investors have to make sure that their money also reaches that particular day that they want to be used as a base for calculation, right? So this was the earlier rule, which is now changed. So under the current rules, the NAV of the same day is considered for purchases of less than 2 lakh, even if the money does not reach the asset management company, but the order is placed within the cutoff time. So if the order is placed before 1 p.m. and even if the money is not reaching AMC and the order is below 2 lakh, then the day of application is going to be considered, and this does not apply to liquid and overnight funds. They have specific, they have different calculations, right? So now this cutoff of 2 lakh, this has been removed, that no matter whatever your payment is, you have to make sure that your money reaches to the asset manager before on that particular day that you want to be used as a base for calculation, right? So if you submit it after 1 p.m., you get the next day's NAV. For liquid and overnight schemes, since they are not covered, they were not covered under this rule, their cutoff time was different. You had to submit application at 12:30. You get the previous day's NAV, and after 12:30, get the same day's NAV, right? So the cutoffs are different for liquid and overnight funds. After that, the cutoff timings were brought forward. So earlier, these timings, they used to be 3 p.m. So this 1 p.m. it used to be 3 p.m. and this 12:30 it used to be 1:30, but they were made a little bit earlier because of the outbreak of COVID and COVID-induced lockdown, right? I hope everything is clear to you and we can move ahead to the next question for today. And here is our next question. Okay, this is question number 4, which says, read the following statements about impact of tariff on supply of inputs and select the incorrect statement. So guys, do pay attention here. You have to select the incorrect statement, not the correct ones, right? So you can pause the video here, read the statements carefully, and then select your answer out of those 5 in the green box. So moving ahead to the solution for this question, and the solution is option E. Option E means 1, 2, and 3. All the 3 statements are incorrect. That means all these statements are false. Now let us try to understand these statements. What are they talking about? So, okay, these statements, they talk about the impact of tariff on supply of inputs. So if a country's government places some sort of extra tariffs on the inputs which are being imported into the country and they are being used in the production processes in the country, if tariff is placed on them, then what is going to be the impact? So usually what happens is, now let's say in India, if government is imposing some tariffs on import, as you can see that recently government is imposing a lot of tariffs on lot of products which have been coming from China to in order to boost our domestic production. Now, how is this going to promote our domestic production? Because these tariffs, they make the imported goods expensive. And if they are made expensive, then there will be a rise in the price of the final good. So let us take an example for this. Let's say there is a car manufacturing company in India. Now this car manufacturing company, it imports some of the raw materials from other countries and then uses those inputs into its production process, right? Now what is happening is tariff is imposed on this input which is being fed into the car company. Now what is going to rise, what is going to happen? The price of the car that this particular company is making is going to rise. Why is this so? Because obviously the inputs that it is using, they are becoming expensive because of the tariff. That is why price is increasing, right? Now, what do you think? Is there a loss to this car company or it is indifferent? So, what we generally talk about is that yes, there is going to be a loss to this company because of this higher price, the demand for its cars is going to fall, leading to lower revenue. But what we have to understand here is that this rise in price, how much fall is it going to induce? See, there are certain products, if their price rises, no matter how expensive they become, everyone buys them. So let's say if there is a medicine that is a life-saving drug to any person who is using them, then if the price of that drug rises, that person is going to use that drug in the same quantity, right? So that means for that product, for that drug or life-saving medicine, the demand is inelastic. That means it is not going to change whether the price rises or falls, right? But there are certain products, let's say here if we are talking about car is not an essential product or not something which is very important to your life, right? So that is why if its price rises, its demand might change a lot or might fall a lot because of the changes price, and we can say that its demand is elastic. So if demand changes a lot in comparison to the price, because of the change in price, it changes a lot, then we say the demand is elastic. And if it doesn't change, then we say the demand is inelastic. So this is the concept of elasticity. So elasticity comes from elastic. just as the elastic stretches, right? So I hope now you're clear with the concept of elasticity. Now coming back here to our statements. See, this first statement, it says if the demand is elastic, a tariff on input of inputs or input supply does not affect the ratio of prices to the cost of imported input. See, if the demand is elastic, that means the demand is going to change. Coming back to our example, we assume that the demand for car is inelastic. That means if price rises, the demand is going to fall. In this case, yes, the car company is going to be in an unfavorable situation because the revenues are going to fall, right? And that is why there is going to be an impact. Here you can see it is saying if the demand is elastic, there is no impact or there it does not affect the ratio of prices of final products to the cost of imported inputs, right? So this is not right. The statement is false. But if the demand would have been inelastic, then there would have been no change because why is it so? Because the producer can easily transfer the rise in price of input to the final consumer and the consumer would consume that product quietly even with the higher cost. But if this car maker, it increases the price, that means it transfers the impact of tariff to the final consumer, then demand is going to fall. That is why the chances are that the car company maker would reduce his or her own profit margin without increasing the price and let price be constant in order to maintain the demand, right? That is why if demand is elastic, then there is going to be an impact. But if demand is inelastic, there is going to be no impact. So the statement would have been correct if there would have been inelastic in place of elastic, right? After that, talking about the second statement, which says if demand is inelastic, producers lose out because of additional tariff. So obviously wrong. We just discussed that producers lose out only if the demand for the product is elastic. In case it is inelastic, consumer is going to absorb that price rise without any reduction in demand or a very less reduction in demand, right? So producer would be in loss if the demand is elastic, right? That is why the statement was incorrect. And after that, the last situation of demand being inelastic pushes the producers to find out overseas suppliers. So if because of tariff from a particular country on products coming from a particular country, if they become expensive due to tariff, then obviously the car maker would try to find out any new suppliers. So let's say if there are tariffs imported on Chinese products or components coming from China, they might want to import the components from South Korea where there are no tariffs and they can import the component cheaply, right? So the situation of demand being elastic, if the demand is elastic, producers face losses and then they look for overseas investors, right? So these would have been the correct statements. So I hope now you understand this concept of elasticity and how is it going to make an impact on producers, right? So moving ahead, I think we have discussed all the points here. You can read them. See, small tariffs are not significant. Okay, one point here. They are saying that there are also costs involved in finding out new suppliers. As we just talked about that the car company maker might go to a South Korean supplier that you supply me with components. But see, there are costs involved in going to the South Korean maker in finding out that particular supplier, right? So if there is a small tariff that is less than those costs, then there is going to be no incentive for finding out a new supplier. But if there are large tariffs imposed on components, then there is incentive to find out a new supplier, right? Okay, moving ahead to the last question for today, which says dual listing clause being considered as a part of new draft regulations for overseas listing may pose as a hurdle for Indian startups looking to raise money overseas. With this dual listing clause, companies have the option to either list in India. Or use a DASH structure where they IPO through their international entities. So guys, this question, it talks about dual listing. So this has been recently in news. Moving ahead to the solution for this question. And the solution here is option C. Option C means that the correct answer is a flip structure. So what is meant by a flip structure? See, here we are talking about dual listing. If you remember, we talked about that how a company, an Indian company, if it wants to list on a stock exchange which is not in India, let's say an Indian startup wants to list on NYSE, New York Stock Exchange, then it would have to first list in India on an Indian stock exchange, then it can go on getting listed onto NYSE, right? So there are loss, there is loss for the companies in this dual listing process, because first they are listing in India, spending money there on compliance costs, and then going overseas, then spending money there again. But they want to go overseas because they want to raise money there, because there are investors with better appetite as compared to Indian investors who are risk averse, right? So we discussed that. Now the problem here is that this question says that if there is a dual listing clause, so we talked about how government is going to make the rules easier for these companies to list overseas, but they are saying that government is saying that okay, we might lose out on some of the rules, but still the companies would have to go for dual listing. They would first have to list in India and then go to abroad for listing. Right. So in this situation, in the situation where there is a dual listing clause, companies have the options either to list in India or they can use a flip structure. Now, what is this flip structure? A flip structure means that let's say there is an Indian company, or let's say there is an Indian startup, because startups are looking to raise money in this environment, especially abroad. As I just told you, foreign investors, especially in the developed countries, they have more appetite for risk as compared to Indian investors. So these Indian startups, they can do one thing. They can create a holding entity, or they can create a parent entity which is not based in India, and that holding entity will list its subsidiary, which is the Indian startup, into a foreign exchange. So that is a flip structure, that by mergers and demergers, creating another holding entity and then trying to list through this particular entity into a foreign stock exchange, right? So this is a flip structure. I hope you are clear about it. As you can see, cost of compliance very high for some companies who are already struggling to meet needs of one listing. Dual listing very harmful for them. After that, another challenge is that SEBI expects Indian companies who are coming for filing an IPO to give a profit, to give a minimum average operating profit of 15 crore for 3 consecutive years. Now SEBI says that okay, if you want to do a public issue, you want to do an IPO, then you would have to show that you have made 15 crores of profit at least in the preceding 3 years, which is very difficult, because many a time startups, even if they are doing well, they consume a lot of cash and they work on their parent entity's money and they are not profit making many a times. Right, but even if they don't make profit, there is a clause for them. SEBI allows them, but the point is, if they are not making profits, then they would have to allot 75% to QIBs. So, guys, we have discussed QIBs in one of our previous sessions. So, 75% of their issue will go to QIBs. That means only 25% is left for the public, which means a very less liquidity, because bigger buyers और QIBs लाइक इंश्योरेंस कंपनीज म्यूचुअल फंड्स दे आर गोइंग टू हैव अ मेजोरिटी स्टेक राइट. सो गाइज दीज वर दी फाइव क्वेश्चंस फॉर टुडे. आई होप यू लर्न समथिंग न्यू फ्रॉम दिस वीडियो एंड इफ यू डिडंट देन डोंट फॉरगेट टू गिव अस अ थम्स अप बिकॉज I'll be back tomorrow with some new set of information. Until then, take care of your health, keep your studies going on, and I'll see you in the next session.